Hi, welcome to our talk on designing your SaaS database for scale with Postgres. I think we're starting about 5 minutes late, so we'll try to like rush through things, the slides. I'm Özgün, the C2 at Citus Data, and
Lucas, also at Citus Data.
And Lucas and I will be co-presenting this talk. We have about 40 slides, and it's a technical talk, so if you have any questions, well, I was going to say feel free to interrupt, but given the time, maybe we keep the questions to the end. And any urgent questions, feel free to interrupt. And before we start, I have a quick question. Prior to this talk, how many of you have heard of Citus? Okay, a fair bit, about half. And we usually hear this question, so I'll spend just 2 slides explaining what Citus is. We'll then dive into the talk. So Citus is a distributed database that uses the PostgreSQL extension APIs. Citus horizontally scales PostgreSQL across multiple machines using sharding and replication behind the covers, so it's all invisible to the user. Citus's query engine parallelizes SQL queries across the machines in the cluster. Most importantly, Citus is open source. If you'd like to try it out, or if you have any feedback for us, please hit us up over GitHub. This is our GitHub repo, Slack, or Google Forums. What are some good use cases for Citus? Citus serves many use cases, and 3 common ones include the ones on this slide list here. First, if you have a multi-tenant database that needs to linearly scale, Citus enables that with minimal changes to your application. Second, when you have a large data set and when you want to get answers from that data in human real time, typically in less than a second, you want to use Citus. Third, if you need to write large volumes of data into your database and you'd like to combine the power of structured and semi-structured data, Citus is a good fit. With that, let's dive right into the talk. Here's a quick talk outline. We're going to start our talk by first defining what it means to scale. We're also going to talk about different ways to scale, and most importantly, when you need to scale. Then we're going to define what a multi-tenant database is. After talking about scale and multi-tenancy, we'll talk about data modeling for multi-tenant databases. We're also going to provide an example database schema just to make that example like more concrete. Next, I'll talk about 3 different approaches to scaling multi-tenant databases. From there, Lucas will take on over the slides and talk about integrating your multi-tenant database into your application. And then he'll do a short demo. Finally, we'll conclude with Q&A. Okay, with that, let's get started by first defining what it means to scale. At a high level, scaling is the process of providing more resources to your application or your database with the intent to improve its performance. Also, as a general rule of thumb, scaling computation is always easier than scaling data. For example, let's say that you have a website that serves customer traffic, for example, Amazon.com. If you needed to scale your front end, you can just provision thousands of servers on the fly, put them behind a load balancer, and scale your website. Doing the same for your database, however, tends to be harder. And in this talk, we're going to focus on scaling databases. When you're scaling your database, you need to think about both hardware and software resources. Usually, though, if you can linearly scale your hardware, you're in a good place to scale your database. We're therefore going to focus on the hardware dimension of scaling. And I'll keep it very brief. In fact, you can scale your CPU or memory or disk in different ways, but I'll just keep it brief for this talk. And I'll start with the first and better known way of scale, which is known as vertical scaling. In this approach, you simply go and buy a bigger machine. In the example here, we have a PostgreSQL database that has 4 CPUs, 30 gigs of RAM, 80 gigs of locally attached storage, and then you need it to scale, so you go and buy this bigger machine that has 4 times the resources, and then you migrate your database from one machine to the other one. And this approach is the simplest way to scale your hardware resources, and we recommend that you always leverage it as long as you can. That said, there is a potential drawback associated with this approach. What is it? Any guesses?
Cost.
Hmm?
Cost.
It costs more, yes. What else? Yes. There is a hard limit to it. You can only scale up to a certain extent, and then you're going to hit a wall. And in that case, you will need to scale out your database into many different machines. When you follow this approach, you can continue to scale your CPU, memory, and storage resources by adding new machines into your cluster. This approach is also known as horizontal scaling, and we're going to talk about it in the later slides in our talk. Now, an important question to answer is, when is the right time to think about horizontal scaling? The answer to that question primarily depends on where in your application and database's lifecycle you are. If you're at a stage where you can throw more hardware at the problem, we recommend that you always do that first. We also recommend spending time in tuning your database's config settings and optimizing your queries. There is a link there. And in other words, we recommend that if you don't need to scale out, don't scale out. With that said, if your SaaS application is growing, there will be a point where you're going to start running into performance issues. So when do you know, like when do you get a sense of, okay, this is the time at which I need to think about scaling out? We've seen numerous customers who looked out to scale out their Postgres database at Citus. In terms of when to scale, I compiled three heuristics that I wanted to share. These aren't rules per se. It's best to think of them as general guidelines. The first one is, if your business is growing and you're on the second largest instance type available on your cloud provider, you probably want to start thinking about scaling out. Why the second largest instance type and not the largest one? Because your business will continue to grow on, and being on the second largest instance type will give you breathing room as your business grows, while you start thinking about scaling and maybe sharding. A second heuristic that usually applies for OLTP type workloads is auto vacuum. Like we hear this frequently. PostgreSQL uses auto vacuum daemons to clean up bloat, and the default vacuum settings are too conservative to begin with. So if you haven't tuned your auto vacuum settings, we have some recommendations here. If you have and you're still experiencing, hey, my vacuum issues, that comes up, now that may be a point to start thinking about scaling out. A third heuristic, and again primarily for OLTP workloads, is how much of your working set your database can serve from memory. Most databases will track how often you hit the cache and when you need to issue disk I/O. For OLTP applications, most of your working set should be served from the cache. Ideally, you'd want to serve 99% of your lookup queries from the cache itself. So in PostgreSQL, a good way to calculate your cache hit ratios is by running these two queries. The query at the top gives you the hit ratios for your tables, and the query below gives it for your indexes. And if your cache hit ratio for your database is starting to drop below 99%, then it may be a good time to start thinking about horizontal scale. To recap, you have several heuristics you can keep an eye out for. By using those heuristics, you can have a sense of the right time to scale. Then when that time comes, what do you do? What are different approaches to scale out? We find that the answer to that question depends on your requirements, and that the following two questions help better identify those requirements. First, are you looking to scale out a database that serves a B2B, B2B2C, or B2C workload? This talk is about scaling B2B workloads. Second, do you have a transactional or an analytical workload? This question is orthogonal to the first one. You could have a multi-tenant database or a B2C application, and you can be interested in serving either transactional or analytical workloads from either of them. This B2B workload lends itself to what's known as a multi-tenant database. If you're building a B2B application, most information relates to tenants, customers, accounts, and your database tables capture this natural relationship. As an example, you could be building a marketing automation tool for other businesses. In this case, each business that you serve, along with their data, becomes a tenant in your database. And the notion of a multi-tenant database isn't new. It's been around for at least two decades. What's new, and primarily in the context of scaling multi-tenant databases, is the cloud. We now have cost-effective SaaS applications. These applications no longer only serve dozens of Fortune 500 companies, but they also power thousands of other businesses. And these SaaS applications more and more rely on open source, and they need ways to scale not only to dozens or hundreds of tenants, but to tens of thousands of or hundreds of thousands of tenants. And further, SaaS applications can store even more information to help their customers. These reasons combined create a distinct motivation to scale multi-tenant databases. Google's F1 paper is a good example that demonstrates a multi-tenant database that scales this way. How many of you here have heard of F1 or read the paper? Okay, just a few. This paper talks about technical challenges associated with scaling out the Google AdWords platform to over 1 million tenants. So if you're a Google AdWords customer, you're one of those tenants within that multi-tenant database. And the paper also describes common RDBMS properties F1 leverages for powering the underlying AdWords platform. Those features include transactions, joins across tables, and database constraints to make sure that each tenant's data remains consistent with each other. The F1 paper also highlights how best to model data to support many tenants or customers in a distributed database. The data model on the left-hand side, which is this one, the traditional relational data model, follows the traditional model and uses foreign key constraints to ensure data integrity in the database. This strict relational model introduces certain drawbacks in a distributed environment, however. In particular, most transactions, if we distribute each table in here, the customer table on customer ID, campaign on campaign ID, ad group on ad group ID, when you do transactions that touch a particular tenant, a customer, they need to span across the network. Or when you're doing joins, you need to bring data, shuffle data across the network. And if you have foreign key constraints in between these tables, you need to enforce those constraints. And if you shard each table on its primary column in the relational database model, then most distributed transactions, joins, and constraints will become expensive. The diagram on the right-hand side shows the hierarchical database model. It's this one, and this is the model used by F1. I won't dive a whole lot into the details. In fact, the hierarchical database model was the predominant database model prior to the relational one. I'll just dive into the simple idea, which is the customer, this is a Google customer, AdWords customer, sits at the top of the hierarchy, and all other tables underneath it, they fall into a hierarchy, and then they're sharded on that customer ID, more or less in simple form, on that field. Does this make sense, the model on this side of the picture? Now, the key benefit to this hierarchical database model is that it enforces data collocation. In its simplest form, you add a customer ID, tenant ID column to your tables and shard them on customer ID. This ensures that data from the same customer gets collocated together, and collocation dramatically reduces the cost associated with distributed transactions, distributed joins, and foreign key constraints. Because when you're operating, you're primarily operating within the scope of a customer. And collocation also simplifies costs associated with handling network and machine failures. In summary, the hierarchical database model brings performance as a key benefit. And let's look at the concept of collocation just a bit deeper. In this diagram, we have three tables: stores, products, and purchases. And all three tables are distributed on the store ID. So we have the store ID one here, products is again distributed on store ID one, and purchases similarly, store ID one. And this way, when you run transactions or joins that are scoped to a particular store, you can always push them down into that machine without having to pay the cost of managing these operations over the network. Collocating tables together sounds great, but what happens if I have a table that doesn't fit into this data model? which is fairly typical. For example, this could happen if you have a web application that serves different accounts or different organizations. And each organization normally has its own like users. However, you may want to simplify the login process for those users who log into not only one organization, but also to the other one. You could handle this user's login table in one of two ways. You could either keep it as a regular Postgres table, or you could shard your user's login table on the user ID column and make sure you don't join it with other tables. A second common table type is small tables that touch across all tenant-related tables. For example, think of time zones. You have a time zones table, or like you have these small dimension reference tables. For these tables, one option is to denormalize them into the larger tables. Another option is to create reference tables that are replicated across all the machines. Now that we talked about scaling multi-tenant databases, let's talk about different ways to implement this approach. So if you'd like to scale your multi-tenant database, we did the what is the scaling, when to scale, and now you want to scale, how do you go about it? At a high level, you have three options. You can create a separate database for each tenant. You can create a separate namespace slash schema for each tenant. Or you can have all tenants share the same tables within that database. Each one of these design options come with different benefits, and I'll look to describe them in the next few slides. In the first approach, you create a separate database for each tenant. From a hardware standpoint, these databases could all be living on the same physical machine, so you could create three of those databases living in one physical machine, or they could be living in separate machines. For example, in this diagram, we have the three databases, and those three databases usually share the same table, index, PL, PG, SQL within them. And each database only holds a particular tenant's data. For example, the database on the left-hand side holds tenant files data. And when you send a query, the query gets routed to that particular database. This approach, creating a separate database for each tenant, optimizes for isolation of tenants. You may need to use this model in industries such as healthcare or finance that impose regulatory requirements. This model also has the benefit that you could give each tenant SQL access to the underlying database and have them run their own queries. I believe Oracle and Azure's multi-tenant database offering follow this approach. And the trade-offs is, if you're not using those products, DBAs now need to manage different databases and make sure that each database gets allocated its fair share of resources. In practice, customers who have isolation of tenants as their primary decision criteria usually lean towards this approach. In the second design pattern, you create a separate namespace schema for each tenant within the same database. From a hardware standpoint, these schemas could again all live on the same machine, or you could add logic to place them on different physical machines. In this diagram, for example, tenant file lives in its separate schema, and all tables and indexes and all that logic actually are scoped to that particular namespace. Before you send a query to the database, you usually first set the search path config setting in PostgreSQL to tenant file schema, and then you send the query to the database. When you think of isolation and scaling as the trade-offs, this second design pattern sits between options 1 and 3. In this model, you can continue to isolate a tenant's data and queries into a particular database schema. Depending on your industry, this may or this may not meet the regulatory requirements. Similarly, compared to the one database per tenant model, this approach does a more efficient job at sharing resources. You now have one database that manages resources allocated to it. At the same time, you may start running into other resource challenges. For example, if each one of your tenants has 100 tables and you have 1,000 tenants, your database needs to maintain 100,000 tables. ORM tools, for example, cache metadata related to all tables in the database when they start up. So now each ORM process would need to cache data related to 100,000 tenants. So there is software resources like associated with this as a question mark. And the third design pattern is one where all tenants share the same tables in a particular database. And again, this database could be distributed across the cluster. In this approach, we simply add a tenant ID column to all your tables and shard them across your cluster. In this diagram, for example, you have three tables, tenants, campaigns, and leads. And you have the tenant ID column across all of those tables. Each lead for a tenant becomes a separate row in that database. And then tenants, you'll see tenant 555 here and data from a separate tenant in that database table definition. And then you ensure that these tables are consistent through database constraints. In this approach, you don't have the strict isolation guarantees as the one database per tenant approach. For example, your application needs to add a tenant ID filter to queries going to the database. On the scaling side, this design pattern easily scales to tens or hundreds of thousands of tenants, since all tenant data lives as rows within regular database tables. This approach also simplifies the operational burden. For example, you can add columns to your database table schema, and the database takes care of all the work for all your tenants. So you don't need to go over each database and add a column that way. So how do you pick between these three design patterns? The truth is, each of these three design options, with enough effort, can address questions around scale and isolation. The decision depends on the primary dimension you're building, optimizing for. A simple rule of thumb is, if you're building for scale, have all tenants share the same tables. If you're building for isolation, create a separate database for each tenant. Now, a natural follow-up question is why having all tenants share the same tables provides better scaling characteristics. The answer to that question comes from our definition of scaling. Scaling is allocating more hardware and software resources to your database. The more efficiently those resources are shared, the better your scaling characteristics get. As an example, if you create a separate database for each tenant, then you need to separately allocate disk, memory, and CPU to each database. If you're running 50 of these databases on a few physical machines, then resource pooling and resource sharing becomes tricky even with today's virtualization tech. If you have a database, a distributed database that manages all these tenants, then you're using the database for what it's designed to do. You could shard your tables on tenant ID and easily support tens of thousands of tenants. Does this make sense? Okay, cool. When all tenants share the same tables, a second related benefit involves operational simplicity. As your application grows, you will iterate on your database model and make improvements. For example, you may need to change the schema for one of your tables or add an index to improve query performance. If you're following an architecture where each tenant lives in a separate database, then you need to implement an infrastructure that ensures that each schema change either succeeds across all tenants or gets eventually rolled back. For example, what happens when you change the schema for 5,000 of your 10,000 tenants and one of the machines in your cluster failed? How do you handle that? When you shard your tables for multi-tenancy, then you're having the database do the work for you. The database will either ensure that an alter table goes through across all shards, or it will roll it back. Before I wrap up, I also wanted to touch upon a question that we hear frequently across all three design patterns. The question is, how does my largest tenant affect my scaling properties? We find that the tenant data in multi-tenant databases usually follows a ZIF distribution. That is, you have a few popular tenants and then a long tail. You might have also heard of this distribution as power law, Pareto distribution, or the 80-20 rule. How many of you in here have heard of the 80-20 rule? Okay, a good chunk. And then they all actually mean the same thing. They're different ways of representing the underlying phenomenon. In this graph, this graph displays it as a ZIF distribution, which is actually the same phenomenon. And to construct this graph, you start with a representative sample of your database. You then take all tenants in that sample set and count the number of rows where each tenant occurred. You then sort those tenants by the number of rows and plot that graph on as a rank on the x-axis. For example, the most frequently occurring tenant becomes number one. So if you think of the Google AdWords infrastructure, this is Google's like most popular tenant. And it has, in this sample set, 100,000 rows associated with it. So it's right here. And then the least popular tenant, tenant 15,000, occurred only once in the sample. And it becomes a data point right here at the very end. So that's the tail, tail end. It's worth pointing out that both the x and y axis in this graph have log-log scale. What that means is if you took a sample that was 10 times bigger, the values and the values in the x and the y axis would change, shift, but this curvature of the graph would stay the same. So it's in the curvature, the like that plot in here, the plot would remain the same, the slope would remain the same. And then the theory behind ZIP or power law distributions helps us in the following way. When you're looking to migrate your single machine database, an important question to ask is, what percentage of the total data size does the largest tenant hold? That is, if your existing database serves 100 tenants and the largest tenant only holds 10% of the data, then this approach will help you scale by 10x. If we assume a standard ZIP distribution, we then come up with the following heuristic for the largest tenant. When you have 10 tenants, your largest tenant roughly holds about 60% of the data. When you have 10,000 tenants, this means that your most popular tenant will have about 2% of the data, and you'll be able to scale to 50x of where you are today. Of course, these are general guidelines, and the best way to tell is by looking at your data. With that, I'll hand it over to Lucas to talk about the application side of the picture.
And I'll take just 2 minutes or so to switch this here.
And as Lucas is switching, if there's one question, maybe.
Cool. Do you always shard by tenant ID, or for some of the big clients, does that end up getting stuck on multiple shards so that they get performance on multiple machines?
The simplest way is to shard on the tenant ID, always shard on the tenant ID. There are ways to shard on one dimension and partition on another, or then even manually shard on two dimensions. Happy to follow up on it. The very simple and the standard way is to shard on the single tenant ID.
All right, and we can take further questions at the end. Also, we are almost at the end. I'll talk a little bit about how to migrate your application to, in this case, kind of a shared multi-tenant database. So this is specifically for something like Citus, but this would apply to anything that matches that concept. And essentially, you know, just to kind of go into some details here, essentially, you know, 1, 2, 3 scale, right? We want to scale here. Kind of the first step you need to do usually is to add the tenant ID to all your tables. So really, that's kind of what's missing often when people start out. They have like complex data models, but not every one of the tables actually references a tenant. To give you an example, let's say we have an e-commerce store with line items, right? And so a line item has an ID. A line item might belong to an order, but then a line item also belongs to the store. And we actually, in this case, want to shard by store, but we don't have it on the table yet. And so essentially, what we're doing here is we need to make sure that we add that to every one of our tables, right? So in this case, the store ID is kind of the tenant ID that we want to shard by and that we want to co-locate data by. And so it's one important step to start with, essentially add this to every one of your tables if it has a tenant reference. And then also add it to the primary key. So we're kind of only enforcing the primary key on a per tenant basis. The second step is to include the tenant ID in all your tables. So if you look at a typical query that your application might do today, it might look for a product, and it looks for the product by a certain ID. And so if you do that in a model like Citus, what you have is you connect to something called the coordinator node. And the coordinator node then has to go to every one of the nodes and gets the data. Sometimes these queries make sense, right? So let's say I want to get a count of all my like orders, right? Or like how much money did I make last month? Across all stores. And so in those cases, this makes sense, and a database like Citus supports that. But in some cases where you're more looking for a single tenant and performance, it often makes sense to essentially kind of prune it down and focus on a single tenant or store by essentially adding that store ID to the query. And then, you know, the coordinator node is essentially a router, so it can essentially, you know okay, this is the node that we need to go for. Then some quick notes here, and we'll share the slides later so you can dive into it more. Essentially, if you have an ORM, you know, kind of the most important step is include the tenant ID in all the queries, right? This means, you know, select, update, delete, insert is kind of usually already done. You want to include the create distributed table call in your migrations. So I'll briefly show that in a quick demo. But that's just, you know, one step you need to do. And then for cross-tenant queries, there's some restrictions with Citus specifically, where, you know, you might have to change some SQL. But typically, we find that people who have a multi-tenant app, they actually have, you know, no problems migrating to Citus within weeks, if not days sometimes. And then, you know, make sure to run your test suite against Citus, right? So, like, that's really, like, where we see a lot of people, they, you know, just, like, make sure you test against the database you want to switch to. And then just a quick note on transactions, kind of work like similar like a single node Postgres. So that's really the benefit for, you know, an actual like OLTP transactional workload where you can actually run transactions and have it work just as on a single node. And DDL kind of, you can do transactions also across nodes. And then just a quick note here, if any one of you is using Ruby on Rails, I'm actually the author of a library for Rails that kind of makes all of this easier. Just as a note, if you are, you should use it. It's called Active Record Multi-Tenant, and essentially makes it easier if you're using Ruby on Rails and Active Record. It makes the work really easy for you, like just drop it in and it works. And you know, for your developers or you, this is going to look like this. So you're just adding like a multi-tenant annotation to every one of your models. In this case, it would be a customer. And then you kind of say, okay, all these queries, all these operations I do in the context of this customer. And then the queries are kind of modified for you and the tenant ID is added. All right, with that, and in the interest of time, I'll do a quick demo. So I have kind of what we call a formation on Citus Cloud. So we didn't touch on this initially. I'm part of the team that runs Citus Cloud. Citus Cloud is essentially a hosted offering that, you know, runs distributed Postgres using Citus. And so you, you know, don't have to run it yourself. You can essentially have us take care of it. And we take care of HA, take care of, you know, enabling you to scale out. I'll just quickly walk you through an example here of how to, you know, work with your data here. So I already opened this, and let me actually do something real quick. Sorry. Don't do this in production, obviously. I'm just cleaning up the data that I just added. And if you do it, do it in a transaction. all right. So we have no data, and actually, let me make this a bit more bigger. Sorry. All right. I hope you can see it. So essentially, we have an essentially empty public schema, and this is, you know, again, we're connecting to the coordinator here. The coordinator behind it has two data nodes, but this could be 20 data nodes, 100 data nodes. It doesn't really matter. Like, what matters to us here is we have a single connection string that we can, you know, connect to make operations on. And again, I'd be happy to share more on this later. Just quickly here, I'll create some tables. And I'll talk about this for a moment here. So essentially, this works just like regular Postgres. But what you do is you mark things as either being a reference table, which is a table that's the same on every node, or you mark things as a distributed table, which is essentially split up across nodes. And so we kind of have like our e-commerce example here. For distributed tables, we shard it by the store ID. And let's see. And this is actually public on GitHub, so I can share the link with you if you come up later after the session. All right. And then, so I'm doing a little trick here because I don't want to copy over to a conference Wi-Fi. So I actually have a separate schema which already has some data. So, you know, typically you would do copy here, but I'm doing an insert into select where I'm essentially just copying the data from another schema. In this case, we actually have, you know, not that much data intentionally, so it's, you know, quick and easy for this kind of showing how it works. But obviously, you could have millions of records, billions of records, terabytes of data, right? It's like, typically, this works best after you have a couple of hundred gigs of data, at least. Before that, you can, you know, use a single node just fine. And then, so, you know, again, we have these tables. And so the nice thing here now is we can run queries. And so really quick example is a count query, right? And if we explain that count query, we can see that the count query actually goes to all the nodes and all the shards. In this case, we have 32 shards for every table. And you can see one example of this, right? And so essentially, it traverses down into that node, and then it just runs regular Postgres on that node. So you get essentially the full power of Postgres, but kind of, you know, distributed and scalable. And I know that there's 10 minutes left, so I'll do it quick. And then here's an example of a kind of multi-tenant query where, you know, we're, in this case, kind of getting which products we have for a certain store. And so here we can see, you know, again, this is all in the coordinator. And like Citus kind of takes care of, okay, you know, identifying this as a multi-tenant query, saying, okay, this goes to single node. And we, again, have regular Postgres underneath on that single node. All right. And then let me show you one more thing, which I think is interesting, which is transactions, right? So a lot of people, if you look at a system like, you know, MongoDB or, you know, other document stores, they often have an issue where, you know, they're not really useful for relational transactional data. And so I think a big benefit of Citus here is that you actually can use transactions. And so let me demonstrate this here. So I'm here looking for certain line items for a certain order. And because, you know, and I want to modify something. So because I know my Postgres skills, I open a transaction, right? Every time you modify something, like just in case, open a transaction. And then we're going to, by accident, delete this data, right? So, you know, at this point, for this transaction, the data is actually deleted, right? So if we run our count again, the count is going to return zero. And so that's kind of, you get the full, you know, Postgres MVCC model here. And then the nice thing is, let's say we want to roll back, and then run it again, and hey, our data is still there. And so this might seem simple, right? But like, if for any system that stores, you know, data that you care about, transactions are really important. And so that, again, kind of, this works on a single, like single node, single tenant basis, right? So there is restrictions if you do it across nodes because it's complex to do deadlock detection across nodes. But essentially, if you, you know, can always prune it down to single tenant, then you have the full Postgres transaction support here, which is a big, big benefit. All right, so I think there's more things I could show you here. What I would suggest is if you're interested in this topic, come up after the session and, you know, we'll either schedule a quick call or at, you know, at the conference, we'll be happy to show more. But I think we should switch to questions. Do you want to come up again? And so let me just put up the slide. Perfect. Well, thank you for listening. Any questions?
So in a situation where your application has multiple releases and the underlying schema will change maybe for some of your tenants, but not all of them, what are your options in that case? You're going to have a totally different database.
Yeah, I think, so would be...
I had a few slides that actually answered that question. That's the second most frequently asked question about this model. I cut them out in the interest of time. In practice, we recommend and our customers use the JSONB HTOR fields to represent that data. So they add for that different use case, like, hey, I have a JSONB column to represent this. We recommend that you do that too. There are other ways of doing it. I had an example from the Salesforce architecture. Happy to go over those slides in detail with you. But for the short answer to that question is, look to use HStore, JSON, or JSONB to represent the differences, data that varies across tenants in this model.
So injecting something between the database and the application?
So if JSONB, are you familiar with JSONB as a data type? So like typically what people would do, they would use JSONB, right? So they would essentially say, if most of my tenants need that field, then you just add it, right? So like you can use typical DDL, like alter table, add column. But if you have data that really varies across, you know, here is this kind of tenant, here's this kind of tenant, then JSONB makes a lot of sense in general, right? Because you have the fixed kind of keys, you have, you know, can index it, but you can be flexible on per tenant basis. But it wouldn't put anything between your application, right? Like it's really just when you're querying, you would query for like a field in the JSONB field instead of like a field on a top level.
Yes.
Pretty much, yeah. Yes. Yeah. And if you aren't using JSONB, definitely take a look because it is, I mean, there's restrictions, but it's a good data type.
Since you have sharding, do you have replication as well? Mm-hmm. So in the case of having the same data on more than one node, in case of failure?
Sure. So we didn't touch on it much. So as I mentioned, I'm part of the cloud team. For Citus Cloud, we use standard streaming replication, but we essentially orchestrate it in a way where, you know, failover becomes a matter of seconds, essentially, which relies on a lot of like primitives on like, you know, like AWS in this case. For on-premise, we also have an offering. It's a bit different though. You know, essentially one issue with HA always is you need to kind of take a look at what are the, you know, what's the storage you work with, what's the, you know, like the objects you use.
So for that one, yeah, we have on the replication side, the answer to your question is yes, and then the particular implementation depends whether you're on cloud or enterprise. Okay. For largest tenants, we have additional functionality within Citus that enables you to isolate the larger tenants into their own machines or into their own hardware. So that one is the third most, like that was the top requested feature. So we have a isolate this tenant feature available built into Citus.
Yeah, and we actually released this as of a couple months ago. So if you look at the blog, we have a blog post on tenant isolation. So, I think there was one question in the back. It's not true for DDL. Yeah, so for DDL, we use 2PC. And we, you know, essentially try to, like, there's still restrictions, I believe, on some of these things, right?
I think the MVCCs, like, the transactional semantics still hold. The machinery with which we push it down to the machines is different.
Yeah.
So we don't, we use 2PC to make sure that it either happens or doesn't, like, it gets rolled back. And for that, we use the underlying primitives available in Postgres.
And we also allow transactions in that case, right? So like essentially in other cases, we essentially don't allow transactions because there is a case where your application, you update one row, you update a different row, and another transaction does the same thing reverse. And if you do that across nodes, you don't have that lock detection, right? So Postgres, if you do it on a single node, will sometimes tell you, hey, there's two transactions, they hold locks against each other, I stop one of them. And that doesn't work on multiple nodes. There's details on what could be done to make that work, but the short answer is, you know, for DDL, yes, for other things, maybe or no.
So I think the answer to your question has, well, has two answers actually. One is data warehousing type workloads. Like we have three use cases and then data warehousing like type workloads fall just a bit outside of them. Still for those workloads, say for real time, if you have a real time application, you can shard on different dimensions. And when you shard on different dimensions, one way to answer like the more complex queries is by doing reshuffling of the data underneath. So if you distribute one table on entity ID, another one on time, so it requires some reshuffling. Citus has support for that, and we're planning on expanding our support for it in our upcoming releases. For this particular use case, where we're looking at multi-tenant applications, we are looking at ways to, I think this goes into the earlier question, hey, can I distribute on tenant ID, but also another identifier? Immediate on our immediate roadmap is we're going to, and we already have customers doing this, sharding all tenant ID and partitioning by time, for example. So there is, so that will give you more capabilities. We're looking forward to Postgres time for that, where you'll like, within the machine you'll get parallelization. For multi-key sharding, we actually have a few customers who do that too, but there is manual effort involved in doing it. So it's not in the immediate roadmap. It's probably, so that's the.
So rather than multi-key.
So part of it has support within Citus. It's not an immediate use case that we're tackling right now. So if we, in this demo, if you run that through, it would work. that again, there are like ways in making it more efficient, and then it's in the like further out roadmap. Yeah.
So, all right, we unfortunately are out of time. So thank you.
We'll be here for a minute.
Just come up to us if you want to talk more.
And we have a tutorial on our website on the different data models. Like, feel free to go in there, like documentation, and check it out.
Yep.